I call to order the November 21st meeting of the Brentwood Board of Aldermen. If you'd all rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Yeah, roll call, please.
Plufka.
Here.
Waggy.
Here.
Lockmuller.
Here.
Kramer.
Present.
Thornton.
Here.
O'Neill.
Here.
Leahy.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
Dimmitt.
Here.
Item number three on the agenda is approval of tonight's agenda. Are there any changes to this evening's agenda? I have one small change. Under presentations number five, I'd like to add a presentation by Chief Curtin regarding a couple of awards that our fire department received. So if the board is...
So moved, Your Honor.
Second.
Any objection by doing it acclamation? Seeing none, that's what we'll do. Item number four on the agenda, consideration and approval of the regular minutes of the regular meeting of November 7th, 2016. Are there any changes or additions to the minutes? Seeing none, by acclamation, they'll be approved. Item number five, presentations. Wow, we're here already. I'd like to ask Chief Curtin to come up and tell us all about why we've received awards.
Good evening. How's everybody tonight? Good. Thank you for taking time to recognize our department. I'm very proud of everybody in that department each and every day. And we were nominated late this summer, early this fall, by a neighboring department for the participation we had with a rescue in a very hostile environment in a neighboring community. And I'd like to read on behalf of the person that nominated us what he wrote and presented to the awards committee. So if you'll indulge me here. It's a little lengthy, but I think it's a good piece. On Friday, March 4th, 2016, at 1:29 hours, engine 3114, rescue 3116, were dispatched for a possible structure fire at 7536 Flora Avenue. Engine 3114 arrived on the scene shortly after being dispatched to find a single-story wood frame house with smoke showing from side A, that's the front of the building. Captain Marsak provided a radio size up and then performed a 360 of the structure, which is a walk around. 3116 arrived on the scene and assisted the personnel from engine 3114 with deploying an 1¾-inch attack line. Crew personnel from Maplewood were preparing to enter the structure when law enforcement arrived on the scene and advised that this was a possible suicide attempt and the suspect may have been barricaded inside and armed. Captain Marsak immediately advised all personnel on the scene to seek shelter behind the fire truck. Captain Marsak also advised dispatch and responding units this was a hot zone and that all responding equipment needed to stage with their vehicles until further notice. There was a moderate amount of dark smoke coming from side A and side D of the structure. Police were unable to gain entry and clear the building due to the smoke. Police advised fire command that the occupant had texted a loved one stating his intentions and that he was going to kill himself. Captain Marsak consulted with Chief Merrill and they determined fire crews would not enter the structure to ensure firefighter safety. The intensity of the fire escalated for several minutes and there was no motion detectable inside the structure. After making the decision not to initiate fire attack, command was advised by law enforcement and neighbors that the occupant had a 6-year-old daughter that resided with him. It was known that Maplewood schools were not in session this particular day, and there was a vehicle in the driveway with a booster seat in the back seat. Fearing that the child may be inside the structure and unable to confirm her location, command, including Chief Merrill, Chief Thorpe, Captain Marsak, and Battalion Chief Brian Wiedemann, determined that it was necessary to enter the structure for the missing girl. The incident action plan was quickly discussed with the crews that would be entering the structure. All the responders without hesitation agreed on the plan to enter the structure. Engine 3114 personnel entered the structure as fire attack after donning Kevlar vests, ballistic helmets, and utilizing a Kevlar shield. Richmond Heights 2114 and Shrewsbury 1814 personnel entered the structure as the rescue group after donning Kevlar vests, ballistic helmets, and another Kevlar shield. Shortly after entering the structure, fire attack advised they located the fire in the kitchen, began extinguishment. The rescue group contacted command and advised they had located a male patient who was unconscious in bed. Rescue group removed the patient from the structure to the front yard where Abbott EMS and fire first responders began CPR and other advanced life support. The patient was resuscitated during transport to the hospital. Engine 2114 personnel continued searching for any additional victims. Fire attack advised that the fire was out and they were performing overhaul. The rescue group was unable to locate a second victim. Approximately 25 minutes into the incident, the missing 6-year-old girl was located at a school in Afton. All fire crews were removed from the structure to preserve the crime scene for investigation. The outcome of the event, the fire was extinguished. The patient that attempted suicide was resuscitated by EMS providers, but later died at the hospital. However, his family elected to donate his organs, which were given to at least 3 different people, resulting in saving their lives, or the quality of lives was greatly improved. Brentwood's role in that, we function in the rapid intervention team capacity, and so we were deployed in the front yard waiting for all of these victims to come out and the firefighters. If they had not and encountered problems, we would have responded in. As it was, a couple of our guys were involved in the resuscitation efforts on behalf of the victim that didn't make it. So this was presented by a neighboring fire department and fire chief, and I'm very proud of the guys for the work they did. I was on the scene that day, and everybody acted very professionally in very harrowing circumstances. Unfortunately, the takeaway from this is that this violence issue continues, and it's reaching closer to home every day. And hopefully it'll end soon because it's too much risk. But that being said, I'd like to present each of our guys with an award from the St. Louis County Fire Chiefs. The department received this plaque back in October, and it hangs in the lobby of our office. So if anybody's interested in seeing that afterwards, I'll be happy to show it to them. Chief Cottrell, can you come up here for a minute? So I'd like to present each one of these guys with their commendation, and Chief Cottrell's gonna do that for me. Lieutenant Bruno, can you come up, please? Thank you very much. Scott Stevens, could you please come up? And lastly, Captain Kerr, would you please come up? We also received a second award. I shouldn't say we. Our recently retired fire chief received the Meritorious Service Award for career development and in the fire service in St. Louis County. And I do not have his plaque. His sons accepted that on his behalf, but I do have a photograph of it, and it's similar to the other one. And I'll read to you what it says. This was the 2016 Fire Chief's Career Service Award presented to Chief Ted Jury of the Brentwood Fire Department for his untiring efforts in training, education, and service to the fire and emergency profession, with sincere appreciation from the Greater St. Louis Area Fire Chiefs Association, the 16th day of October 2016.
So. All right. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
We don't have any public hearings on the agenda tonight. We don't have any bids to open. That brings us to item number 8 on the agenda, which is the hearing of any matter of public interest upon the request of any person present. If anyone would like to address the Board of Aldermen, please come forward, state your name and address, and you'll be given 3 minutes to address the board.
Hi. So that I don't forget, Louise Charbonneau, 8833 Madge.
So that I do not forget, I hope all of you have a wonderful, family-oriented, lovely Thanksgiving. I'm not cooking for the first time in 100 years. I want to address Bill 6098, which is up for the second reading tonight with regard to the site plan and conditional use application for on Manchester Road. AMCO Dent Team Commercial Transmission Shell Gas Station RPM Auto Repairs Speedway Automotive, and then just, did I say Meineke? And then just to the western border of Brentwood are Midas and Steger. Those are the names of all automotive service businesses, the first several except for the last two, located along Brentwood stretch of Manchester Road. I went to my old comprehensive plan today looking for specifics, and of course we know that in those days comprehensive plans were meant to be a guideline. They do not have the force of law. But the predominant word in this comprehensive plan is mixed use. And additions of another automotive use on that stretch of Manchester Road go so thoroughly against the feel of what mixed use means. In the section on future land use mapping, the residents referred to the north side of Manchester Road to be neighborhood mixed use, the south side to be commercial mixed use, which would provide for larger, because there's greater lot depth on the south side of Manchester Road. My concern is that by AMCO moving across the street, which, and I admitted earlier, is a very attractive applicant because he's got a history with Brentwood and he enjoys being in Brentwood, is that the vacated building will now be fostered to another automotive use. I don't know that you can take what's been used as an automotive use with gasoline and the assorted smells into something else. And so then we'll have this other building, which is now occupied by Exterior Building Solutions, turned into a building that can only be used for an automotive use. So I don't know if it's enough for you to hang your hats on, but I did uncover that the City of University City has a forgivable loan program that they're using to attract mixed uses, unique businesses, small businesses, to particular areas in their town, such as the Loop and Olive Street Road. And maybe Brentwood, for the next year, could look into something like that to try to attract a greater mixed use. Everything in the comp plan wanted walkable Brentwood, wanted the chance for encounters on the sidewalks where I run into Mr. Thornton and say, well, how are you doing today? And we have a small chat. That's what community is. So that's my thoughts on that. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Leo Neese. I am the owner of Exterior Building Solutions. And as you all know, that in the last year, we've had two floods down in that area. And my business flooded out both times. Each time I flood out, it cost me about $25,000 between insurance deductibles, things that the insurance company doesn't cover, moving expenses while the place is being renovated, rent in a new location while it's being renovated. And a third flood could very possibly put me out of business. You know, I just hope you take a good look at this. AMCO is, you know, a good solid business, and I think having an AMCO in my current location would be better than having a vacant building. So thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Tim Monteleone. I own the AMCO here in Brentwood. The last meeting, there were a couple questions that were brought up that I just wanted to address. Mr. Lee, you had asked a question about parking cars on Helen Street. Mm-hmm. We would never park a customer's car on a street for a lot of different reasons, but no, and we would not park our own cars on the street.
Thank you.
We've been where we're at now for 5 years. We actually have shared parking. And we have, been good tenants there and worked with everybody else, and we park where we're supposed to. We keep abandoned vehicles out of our lot. We do everything we can to make sure the cars come in and go out without setting for a long time. And so I just wanted to kind of, you know, knock that issue down. There was another mention about loud noises, things like that. We're a transmission shop. We're not a tire shop. Tire shops, you hear the zzz, zzz, all day long. We don't do tires. We don't do alignments. The majority of what we do is taking a transmission out of a car. It goes on the builder's bench. The builder rebuilds it, and it goes back in. The majority of that work is done with good old wrenches and ratchets. So we're a lot quieter shop. We don't have the volume of business because of what we do like a regular shop would when you look at, say, a Firestone, a Dobbs, or something like that. Most days, I would say we probably have three customers a day in our shop. I'd like to have more, but we're more of a shop that kind of provides a higher expense service for the cars, and that's mainly what we're in business for. We do other things, and sure, we'll replace your water pump or your fuel pump or whatever, but AMCO's really not known for that, and so the majority of our customers that are coming in there are just coming in there for the transmission service. I don't know if you have it in front of you, but I did provide the pictures of what we're planning to do with the property, and I think if you've seen the pictures, the AMCO corporate office has really done a nice job of how we're going to lay out the new awning and the graphics and the paint and everything, and I think it'll really upgrade and make the property look a lot nicer. At the same time, the property that I'm in right now, I feel is a little run down, and I think that by me moving across the street, it's going to cause my landlord to have to do some nice upgrades to that property to be able to attract a new tenant. So I'm hope the end result of what you would get is two new upgraded properties in exchange for letting us move across the street. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Hello, good evening. I'm Tony Bowman. And I am the board secretary for the Brentwood Century Foundation. I'm coming before you tonight to give you a quick little update on what the foundation's been doing since we were here the last time, and the last time I was here was in January. The foundation has met with various civic groups and organizations and has held an open community meeting. A board of 15 plus two alternatives have been gathered, and these represent a diverse cross-section of our community and our residents, past and present, and our businesses. The full board began meeting on a quarterly basis this summer. We met in July and we met in October. Our next meeting is in January. We have a lot of work planned for 2017. We have two main goals for the year, in addition to holding fundraising events, and they are defining our events for 2019 and trying to nail down estimates to help in drawing up a budget for each event and defining any projects we wish to accomplish to mark the occasion. And we'll need to nail down quotes for those as well. This summer, the city worked hard to draw up a bill. It was 6069. And as a reminder, this is an ordinance authorizing a contract between the city and the foundation for the purpose of providing certain services related to the upcoming centennial. We want you to know that our officers are ready to sign the contract agreement, and we would like to ask that the bill be reintroduced as soon as possible. We believe that we'll have no trouble obtaining any information that you might need and reporting to you at any time. As for right now, the foundation has a few needs. We still need funds to help finish the construction of our website. We need funds for marketing materials right now. And we also have a need to have a production company begin interviewing our oldest citizens for a documentary we wish to compile for the centennial. That documentary will not be filmed all at once, but interviews need to begin, and they will be pieced together in 2018. We can produce quotes to you regarding the cost of these things. And thank you very much. That's it.
Thank you. Anyone else care to address the board? Oh.
Hi, my name is Catherine Zaniel. I live on Madge Avenue. As you know, it's a very active, politically hotbed of community, not only news, but, you know, political incentives to try and get more citizen participation. So I think that's great. But my comment has to do really with the bills that are being given a first reading or second reading, and they impact the budget. In other words, I see that there are bills, you know, authorizing an option or an extension of three-year services for different types of contracts, and really wanted to know if the rest of the board and the citizens could be aware of the percentage increase in costs over a period of time. I mean, and I don't know if the, you know, maybe the Ways and Means Committee has addressed that, but I think when you, you know, extend, you know, an optional contract for like a three-year period, that some sort of, you know, some sort of, you know, I guess, you know, just for the citizens, some sort of, you know, impact on the budget, you know, should be stated. So that's all I have to say. So in any of these bills that maybe have an impact on the budget, like Bill 6102, Bill 6104, you know, Bill 6052, if they do have an impact on the budget, and maybe the Ways and Means Committee could address this, you know, is this, are we authorizing contracts that increase substantially over a period of, you know, however long the length of the contract goes? Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else care to address the board this evening? Okay, seeing none, do we have any aldermanic response? Alderman Lockmiller.
Well, I would like to address the issue regarding the Brentwood Century Foundation. I'd kind of like to see the board maybe revisit that issue at the December 5th meeting, either through the bill, as Ms. Bowman mentioned, or maybe through a resolution. And I'd be, with your help, Mayor, and staff, I'd like to maybe offer up that bill at the next meeting of the Board of Aldermen. Thank you.
Okay. Any other aldermanic response? I'll say a couple words about the budget question that was asked. So what you see in front of you is really a summary. It would be impossible for, this is the packet we received before we come to a meeting. And we wouldn't want to give that out to everybody in paper form, but we certainly, most of this available is online. We get an analysis of all that, and staff summarizes the, you know, the effects of a contract extension for us. So, what I can tell you is the board is aware of what they're authorizing and how much they're authorizing. Whether or not it's reasonable, well, that's a matter of judgment, but it's certainly the board's judgment when they authorize it, that they're authorizing some sort of reasonable increase, if any increase is authorized. So, but again, the other thing I would tell you is that on our city's website, there's a transparency portal, and the transparency portal allows you to see actually every single check that gets cut from the city's treasury that goes out, and all of the accounts rolled up, how they track to the budget every quarter. So you can look and see in as real a time as possible how we are tracking to our stated expenditures over time, and that's available to everybody. It's on the city's website. So that information is all available, and obviously if you have any questions, you can talk to City Administrator Conde or Director of Finance Karen Shaw. So.
No, that's great. Thanks.
Any further aldermanic response? Okay. We don't have any unfinished business this evening. That puts us on item number 10, bills to be given first reading. Mr. City Attorney, bill number 6102 by title only, please.
Bill number 6102, first reading, an ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to exercise an option on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri, to extend the current business associate contract between EMS Management and consultants in the city of Brentwood, Missouri for 2 years, commencing on January 1, 2017, and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
Thank you. Alderman Kramer, synopsis, please.
Yes, Your Honor. Bill number 6102, the Business Associate Agreement, the first reading this evening, covers a bill for an ordinance authorizing the mayor and our city administrator to exercise an option that on behalf of our city to extend the Business Associate Contract Agreement between EMS Management Consultants and the city for 2 years, commencing January 1, 2017, and running through December 31st of 2019. This service agreement is to protect the medical information obtained by the Brentwood Fire Department during the performance of their duties and responsibilities. The agreement is required per the Health and Information Portability Act, otherwise known as HIPAA. The EMS Management and Consultants, EMS-MC for Ambulance and Billing Service, and ESO Solutions Electronic Patient Care Reporting, the EPCR software, which will also be used for patient care reporting on Brentwood's ambulance agreements, all contained within Bill number 6102.
Thank you. Chief Curtin, you have information for the board on this?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So, a little history. In 2013, Chief Jury at the time went out for bids for patient reporting billing services. The company we were using had not been bid against in quite some time, so the state audit had recognized that, and this was one of the first things that he did to get that rebid out and took us to where we are today. They chose EMS Management Consultants. He and Gina Jarvis at the time did a lot of research, created the RFP, and went out for bid. After they did all the tallies of the bids, EMS-MC was chosen for the new billing company for Brentwood. Part of that three-year contract included a two-year optional extension. That's what I'm here asking you for today. The service we receive from EMS-MC is outstanding. I feel very confident with them. They're very easy for us to work with. Also, part of that brought on a new emergency software reporting system for our patient reporting that has also been very good to work with. They're two separate companies, but they work closely together, and we learned of ESO firsthand when we chose EMS-MC. So there's no connection in the two, but I just wanted to let you know about that. So there is no additional cost to extend this 2 years. It's going to remain at the same 7.25% based on our collected revenue. As you can see on my memo, that the revenue stream dropped a little bit in 2015. When I pressed them for information on that, they said that company-wide they saw a lot of decrease in revenue on ambulance billing due to the National Health Care Act and higher insurance individual deductibles. People's deductibles are in the ranges between $3,500 and $5,000. And what they're finding is that the insurance companies are obviously not paying as many of the bills. It's falling on the individuals. And it's easier to collect money from the insurance company than it is from individuals. And so that was their answer to me when I pressed them on that. The good news is it has started to rebound in 2016, and that was positive. So at this point, we're asking for a first reading tonight and an overall approval at the next meeting. So,
does any member of the board have questions for Chief Curtin? Alderman Leahy.
Chief, what you're suggesting then is in 2015 and in 16, we're writing off a lot more bills?
No, we're not writing. Well, we're not writing them off. They're going into collections, and collections works on them to the point where they can't get anything, and that goes on for a while. It's not something that's written off in a couple of weeks or a couple of months.
But we're paying the firm based on what we do actually collect in.
That is correct. Right. Yeah, we don't pay them anything until we get the check for it.
Money in the hand.
That's correct.
Any other questions for the chief? Thank you, Chief.
Thank you. I guess I'll stay right here.
Yeah, stick around. Mr. City Attorney, item 10B, Bill number 6104, first reading, please.
Bill number 6104, first reading, an ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into and execute a renewal of a 3-year service and maintenance contract between Physio Control, Inc. and the City of Brentwood, Missouri for 3 years, commencing on December 6, 2016, and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
Thank you. Alderman Kramer, synopsis?
Yes, Your Honor. Some added detail for the layman. Bill number 6104, the first reading, covers the three-year renewal of the service and maintenance agreement with Physio Control Incorporated, and covers an ordinance authorizing our mayor or city administrator to enter into that agreement. The renewal of 3 years for the service and maintenance with Physio Control LLC provides all of the preventative maintenance, repairs, and annual certifications for all of the fire department and citywide heart monitors and defibrillators that for 3 years commencing December 6th of this year, all contained within the language of Bill number 6104.
Thank you. Chief, what can you tell us about
okay.
this one?
All right, so Physio Control is the vendor that we have that sells us our heart monitors and defibrillators. We have, let me make sure I don't misspeak on this. We have several items on these pieces of equipment. We have three monitor defibrillators, and then the rest of the items that we have maintained by those folks are AEDs that are all over the city, as the synopsis said. We also have one other device. It's an external CPR device that we strap onto the patient's chest that's made by the same company, and that does CPR on the way to the hospital to free up hands for the medics to do other things. So what we do with those is, in a hospital setting, they do what's called a bio test on a regular basis. They come around each department and they verify that each device, whatever it might be, is working within normal specifications and limitations. And so this is a similar procedure for out-of-patient equipment maintenance. The Physio Control is, again, the manufacturer. It's the factory-authorized service arm of that company. They come to us. They bring everything they need. We generally can get whatever we need off their truck. We've done business with them for the last 3 years, and the contract is running out very shortly, and so we're asking that you all consider allowing us to renew this contract. We did add some equipment in 2015. We added a couple of two new AEDs that were placed in the new rec center. We've also experienced two price increases since the last contract was signed, and we have changed the maintenance care on a couple of our pieces of equipment to full maintenance, and let me make sure I read the right. There's that piece of paper, I don't want to misquote it. We've upgraded three pieces of equipment from inspection only to comprehensive repair and inspection level. So that means they'll take care of everything. It doesn't have to leave the building. So that's essentially what we're asking for. The price did go up. I outlined that in my memo. It's gone up approximately $3,000 a year for this renewal, but the reasons I gave you were why. So this is the factory authorized service. I recommend using them. One of the big reasons is just liability protection on behalf of the city, because it's their equipment. And there's really not many vendors out there that will even do this, and it would be a big search to find them. So.
Are there any questions for the chief? Alderman Plufka.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So we had 10 devices through this current contract, seven AEDs and three.
Yes, I believe that's correct.
And you added two AEDs to this mix?
We did. They put two brand new ones in the rec center when it was remodeled.
So does that mean that we're dealing with nine AEDs now? And
what did I have
three?
On? Let me go back to my, I got to look at my sheet of paper. I apologize.
No, that's all right.
So we are going from, God, let me make sure, let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 11 pieces of equipment.
Okay, so from 10?
Yep.
Previously? So one additional device, and then you said there were two price hikes.
So the reason for the price increase is, I'll run through those again. We combined two service plans into one. We had two separate plans. That's all now going to be written under one. We upgraded our three LifePak 1000s from service to inspection and comprehensive repair. And then we've had two price increases that we did not have to absorb in our current contract that we will have to absorb now. And then we added the two AEDs at the rec center.
Were the two price increases that you didn't have to absorb then, but are absorbing now, Were they just, was there ever any explanation from the vendors?
No. When I asked him what the reason for the increases were, he only indicated that they had been two price increases that we did not have to pay in under our last contract.
Okay, so part of this increase from $5,000 to $8,000 has to do with one additional piece of equipment. Some of it has to do with a little more comprehensive maintenance and work on some of the
correct.
Pieces of equipment. And then just some of it is just two price hikes on the
correct.
Part of the vendor.
Right.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're
thank
welcome.
You, Mr. Mayor.
Any further questions for the chief? Seeing that. Thank you, chief.
Thank you.
All right. Item number 11 on tonight's agenda. 11A is second reading of bill number 6052.A. Mr. City Attorney, first reading, second reading by title only, please.
Mr. Mayor, I believe the board has before it a staff recommended amendment red line to the bill as previously introduced and bill number 6052.A. It is staff offers this for the consideration of the board. If you wish to consider that amendment before second reading. The amendment is into the first prefatory clause and identifies the area of the project with greater precision.
Your Honor, motion to amend Bill 6052 to the 6052 point A as amended in red line on page 1, paragraph 1.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board adopt the amendment suggested in 6052A. Is there any discussion on the amendment? Seeing none, all in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Great. The bill as amended, Mr. City Attorney, I guess, do we need to do a first reading or can we do a second reading?
Second reading.
Second reading. Thank you.
Bill number 6052 is amended, second reading and consideration for adoption. An ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to execute an amendment to a professional services agreement on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri with O.R. Colon Associates for right-of-way negotiator services for the Hanley Industrial Court project.
Thank you. Chair would entertain a motion on the bill, or you've already done that.
Motion, Your Honor, to perfect Bill 6052 point A as amended into ordinance form.
Second. So just for the benefit of the audience, we've got quite a few here tonight, so I'm going to ask Alderman Kramer to read the synopsis just so everybody can follow along with Mitch.
Sure, Your Honor. Bill number 6052A, this is our second reading now for the amended agreement for the right-of-way negotiator services. Bill covers an ordinance authorizing our mayor or city administrator to approve an amended professional services agreement. That's for right-of-way negotiator services, that's to cover our Hanley Industrial Court project, STP 5577, parenthetical 632, a federally funded project consisting of sidewalks and pedestrian lighting, which will bring much-needed pedestrian improvements to an area inside the Hanley Industrial Court that experiences a heavy volume of pedestrian traffic. O.R. Colon submitted their proposal for the Hanley Industrial Court project with plans that showed parcels 3 and 4 being contiguous and with the same ownership. So they only proposed one compensation estimate and one negotiation for these two properties. The properties have separate ownership, and thus O.R. Colon has now included an extra compensation estimate and extra negotiation. This is a request to be paid for the additional services. Inside the language of bill number 6052.A.
All right, thank you. Now, if somebody would move for the adoption, I think Alderman Leahy was in the process of that.
Yes, sir. Motion to perfect bill 6052 point A as amended into ordinance form.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that the board adopt 6052A into ordinance form. Is there any discussion? Alderman Leahy.
2 weeks ago, Your Honor, I asked the question about this error in judgment from the lots 3 and 4 being continuous to being not continuous. In the packet 2 weeks ago, it presented the letter from O.R. Colon that established that they made that error back in 2016 at the very beginning, and that they're asking the correction. I made the request at that time that had the city had discussions with them, that instead of the city picking up the full cost of the $1,930 to pick up this arrangement, if it would be a negotiated arrangement,
At the time, no negotiation had happened. I am curious, in the last 2 weeks, if maybe that topic was broached with OR colon?
I don't believe it has been.
That's correct.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Plufka?
Yes.
Weggie?
Yes.
Lockmiller?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
O'Neill?
Yes.
Leahy?
No.
Sims?
Yes.
Dimmitt?
Yes.
Okay, motion passes. Bill 6052A now becomes ordinance 4751.
We'll let it slide. Okay. Remind me to talk to you afterwards about that. They're used to hearing that upon signature by the mayor, it'll become ordinance.
I'm sorry. Upon signature of the mayor. Bill number 6052A.
It's all right.
Could become.
They want me to hassle the new guy. I don't understand.
Hey, if you can't have fun at what you're doing, something's wrong.
All right, 11B on the agenda, tonight's agenda. And do we need to do an amendment for this one as well, Mr. Sid? No, okay. So, second reading by title only, bill number 6091.A.
Bill number 6091A, second reading and consideration for adoption and ordinance of the City of Brentwood, Missouri, amending the comprehensive fund balance policy, providing for the effective date of this ordinance, and providing for the repeal of all conflicting ordinances.
All right, Alderman Kramer, you want to tell us a little about it?
Yes, Your Honor. The second reading this evening for bill number 6091.A, amendments to the comprehensive fund balance policy, was covered by the Ways and Means Committee members, who reviewed and recommended the minimum operating reserves, the unassigned fund balance goals for the general fund, be increased from 15% of budgeted operating expenditures to 50%. At present, there's no financial impact resulting from this amendment. Our Ways and Means Committee members voted unanimously in recommending this be forwarded to the Board of Aldermen for their consideration. Bill number 6091.A.
Thank you. Chair would entertain a motion. And I'm hearing crickets.
I move that the bill be perfected.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board perfect bill number 6091A into ordinance form. Is there any discussion on the ordinance? The bill, sorry. Alderman Kramer.
Yes, Your Honor. I don't recall the exact year we did it, but it wasn't that long ago. We had this discussion in the Ways and Means Committee regarding the recommendations of GASB number 54 and the guidelines that the city previously did not have in place, probably missing for some time. And I see the wisdom of the Ways and Means Committee now wishing to adjust the goal target amounts. This bill gave an opportunity to go back and look at the language that we approved at the time, even though it is technically a guideline which should be adhered to. There is some language that potentially could be tightened up. I spoke with our city administrator this afternoon about the topic of the language itself, and then the percentages was the second part. As far as the language goes, it's a little ambiguous. And to be honest, Your Honor, we probably could have done a better job at detailing this out when we approved it. It was our first run at it at the time. And it seems to intimate that if the unassigned fund balance falls below the goal or has a deficiency, the city will plan to adjust the budget. And I think the intention was, if the unassigned fund balance were to fall below the minimum balance, which in this case is 10%. So I guess I would pose the question that while the 50% of budgeted operating expenditure goal is admirable, and incidentally, we happen to be close to that now, I think the real reason for the policy and some of the precepts in the GASB 54 talked about the importance of having the minimum, in this case, the cause for concern, which we set at 10%. The city is in a much better position now than we were when we had this initial discussion. If you go back to 2011, the unassigned, unrestricted fund balance for the general fund stood at about $450,000. Now we're 10 times that. We've done a very good job at saving and taking advantage of cost benefits through bidding processes and perhaps less spending. So I guess Your Honor, what I'm proposing is that if the board seems that they see fit to change the goal to 50% and leave the 10% minimum alone at the same time, I would propose that either we consider raising that 10% even a little bit to 15 or 20%, below which would be the cause for concern, ensuring that we have a little bit more of a minimum. And then also, there was the conversation, which I'd like to hear our city administrators take again, regarding that 50%. There are some other cities in our comparator sphere that are more in the perhaps 35, 37, 38% range. I'm not opposed to 50, but I think the minimum should be raised. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman Plefka.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I come at it from a little different standpoint than Alderman Kramer. My concern about that same language is that we are proposing a budget this year that will not get us to 50% reserve. And that sentence, if I'm reading it correctly, says that if the unassigned balance falls below a goal or has a deficiency, and certainly we're in a deficiency right now, I think we're at 42% right now, it says the city will plan. Now, my understanding of ordinance language and statutory language is that will is a commanding word. It says they will, they shall, they have to. If we adopt this and then adopt a 17 budget that doesn't get us to that 50%, are we actually in violation of our comprehensive fund balance policy that we're just now adopting? That's my concern. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion?
Could we get an answer to that question?
May we hear from the city administrator?
If the city administrator would care to address it, sure.
I thought that perhaps Mr. O'Keefe could help us understand what the word will mean and how it's directing the city administrator to take action or like thereof.
Oh, by all means, City Attorney O'Keefe, educate us on statutory construction.
Thank you. I appreciate that. lawyers generally are not good at solving philosophical political disputes among policymakers. The word will is mandatory.
You can say that again. Oh.
is a directory. It is a requirement. The problem, however, of course, is that there is no penalty. You all get to change this policy. You know, your successors can change this policy. It's not like you don't get paid or you get locked up if you don't do it, or that the citizens have to chip in and give you more money. The fact is that these are aspirational goals. These are principles that should be adhered to as a matter of principle. But in terms of being compulsory, or there is some pain involved for failure to achieve, there is none.
Right.
So it again, because you all collectively, the judgment of the city rests with you. So you can bring into conformity any piece of past enactments, which are problematic. Because you all collectively have the power to change the city's policies. So that's why, while it is the use of the word will or shall is in legislation is mandatory, it's not quite like thou shalt not kill, which carries a real penalty, such as eternal damnation. Do not face eternal damnation if you fail to achieve
the under certain judicial systems, you mean.
You may face political damnation. That's a
different. All right. Alderman Wege.
So, as part of the Ways and Means discussion around this, the intent is definitely not to force the board to have to do something to meet that 50%. The intent is really, as it stands at 15%, we would be presenting a different budget than we are tonight in terms of with a expected 44% general fund reserve coming out of this year, we almost should be spending more to try and get back down to that target of 15%, if you will. So that's why I thought it was important to get this up to 50%. to help us set that target. We've asked a question a couple times about, does this force us to drive us to 50% of a general fund reserve? The question we keep getting is no, but the fact that it keeps coming up probably means there is some ambiguity here in this language. So I don't know, maybe a better wording is falls below the 10% goal to clarify which goal we're talking about, because we have a target and we have a 10%.
That's
and
right.
I think the intent of the 10% target is that action does need to be taken at that time.
That's right.
Alderman Dimmitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To address the concerns of Alderman Plufka, the way I read this, it's the goal of the city to achieve, hypothetically, the 50%.
Right.
The next paragraph, if unassigned fund balance falls below the goal, then the city shall, or the city will, make appropriate adjustments to get it back to restore the balance. Implicit in that is that at some point in time, we were at the 50%, which we aren't. So that language in that paragraph doesn't come into play until we reach the 50%, and then if we fall below the 50%. Because the two modifiers in there, don't you love lawyers?
Yeah.
The city will plan to adjust the budget to restore the balance.
No.
Well, we never were at the 50% balance.
I can answer that question. Alderwoman O'Neill.
All right. I think we need to look at the rest of the sentence. It says the city will plan to adjust the balance in the subsequent fiscal years, plural. It doesn't say the next year we must jump up to 51%. It says
That's
we
true.
Will plan. We don't always make our plans, but we plan. So the only will in this, to me, is that we will plan if there is a problem.
Alderman Kramer.
Yes, Your Honor. Following up on some of the comments that were just made about the wording, I guess I wanted to reiterate the initial intent when this was put into place was to have a goal and then to have some alarm bells if we go below a minimum. To the extent that we've discussed this evening, the possibility of referring to that minimum is something that I think would be worthy. I have no problem voting on this now. If the board so chooses not to include the word minimum in that sentence that we've just now spoken of, I hope that the Ways and Means Committee will take that into consideration as a new amendment at a subsequent meeting.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, if we're ready for the question, roll call, please.
Plufka?
Yes.
Weggie?
Yes.
Lockmiller?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
O'Neill?
Yes.
Leahy?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Dimmitt?
Yes.
Okay. Motion passes, and upon signature of the mayor, Bill 6091.A will become Ordinance 4752.
Thank you. Item 11C on tonight's agenda is Bill number 6098 for second reading. Mr. City Attorney, second reading by title only, please.
Bill number 6098, second reading, in consideration for adoption, an ordinance granting approval of a site development plan and conditional use permit to Tim Monteleone Properties, LLC, for an automotive business, AMCO Transmissions, for property numbered 8503 Manchester Road, which permits under the provisions of Title IV, Chapter 400 of the Brentwood Code of Ordinances, the development of that site, providing for the conditions of such development and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
Alderman Kramer, synopsis, please.
Yes, Your Honor. The subject of previous hearing and discussion, Bill number 6098, the second reading now for the site development plan conditional use permit for an automotive business, otherwise known as AMCO Transmissions, located now at 8503, or to be known at 8503 Manchester Road. The bill is for an ordinance granting approval of the site development plan and conditional use permit, CUP, to Tim Monteleone Properties, LLC, that for an automotive business, AMCO Transmissions, for the property numbered 8503 Manchester Road, which permits under the provisions of Title IV, Chapter 400 of the Brentwood Municipal Code of Ordinances, the development of that site. Planning and Zoning Commission did vote on this topic, voted 9 to 2, suggesting the site plan subcommittee meet with Mr. Monteleone to review proposed paint and awning colors that to complement the surrounding businesses and the area. Mr. Nelson seconded the motion, and this is all contained within the language of bill number 6098.
All right, thank you. The chair would entertain a motion.
Your Honor, I'll make the motion to perfect bill 6098 into ordinance form, please.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board perfect bill number 6098 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion? Alderman Kramer.
Yes, Your Honor. The previous discussion at the last meeting revolved around some of the hurdles, I guess, that the Planning and Zoning Commission were reviewing in terms of a conditional use permit, and one of those had to do with the comprehensive plan, and that to be considered whether or not this particular application met the spirit or intention of the comprehensive plan that we currently have in place. We have heard some negative comments and some positive ones about this application, being that it is an existing City of Brentwood business that has fully complied with all ordinances and restrictions placed upon it to this moment, and wishing simply to move across the street. I don't know that I would be opposed to or would wish to penalize an existing Brentwood business that may not be in line with some visions of the comprehensive plan or interpretations. This is in a lateral move versus a new entry, and so I would be in favor of this application. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman Lockmiller.
Well, I do have concerns on moving an automotive repair to the other side of Manchester Road, abutting residential property, and I do feel it adversely affects the character of the neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman Leahy.
2 weeks ago when we had the conversation, Alderman Lockmiller asked about the side lot number 4. That lot is zoned residential, according to our city layout lots.
Thank you.
Alderman Plufkin.
Can I ask a question about that? Does that, that's the lot that's immediately south of a...
The old Tesson Farms location.
Okay.
North,
yeah.
North of it.
Right. It's immediately, north of it. Immediately, yes. North of it, I meant. Mm-hmm. Right, that's right. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Any further discussion? Okay, we're ready for the question. Roll call, please.
Plufka?
Yes.
Waggy?
Yes.
Lockmiller?
No.
Kramer?
Yes.
O'Neill?
Yes.
Leahy?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Dimmitt?
Yes.
Motion passes upon mayor's signature. Bill number 6098 will become ordinance number 4753.
All right, thank you. That brings us to item number 12 on the agenda, bills to be given a first and second reading. We have one item. It's bill number 6103. Mr. City Attorney, first reading by title only, please.
Bill number 6103, first reading, an ordinance authorizing the city administrator to enter into a temporary construction easement, permanent wall and sidewalk easement agreements between the City of Brentwood and Envelope Manufacturing Company at 200 Hanley Industrial Court, Brentwood, Missouri, 63144.
Thank you. Alderman Kramer, synopsis, please.
Yes, Your Honor. Bill number 6103, as we heard, this is our first and second reading this evening at once for the Hanley Industrial Court Pedestrian Improvement Federal Project number STP-5577, parenthetical 632 for the TIP 6306-15. Bill covers an ordinance authorizing the city administrator to enter into a temporary construction easement, permanent wall and sidewalk easement agreements that between our city and Envelope Manufacturing Company located at 200 Hanley Industrial Court. This is a surface transportation program grant project for STP. The total project cost $938,881. The federal match for the project, 80%, $751,105. Our local match is 20%. That's $112,776. And the Hanley Industrial Court Association, $50,000 with a pelagic match of 25. This project expands the sidewalk system within Hanley Industrial Court, a much welcome improvement, all contained within the language of bill number 6103.
Thank you. Okay, this is like the sixth or seventh one of these to come before us. If there are any questions, Dan Gummersheimer is here, and I'm sure he'd be happy to answer them, but we should be fairly familiar with these by now. Alderman Leahy.
Question I have for Dan is we're staying within the budget that the grant's permitted. It's my impression that these agreements are getting more and more expensive and that we might be pushing close to a ceiling limit.
That is correct. I'll find what's in here. Yeah, according to paperwork here, I'll find it. Yeah, what was submitted on this, the request for right-of-way acquisition authority, which was submitted on March 2016, that had a budget of $145,000, of which federal is $116,000, local match is $29,000.
Understand, but
right.
Based on all of these plats that we're now agreeing to, we're staying within the budget of the allocations?
Correct.
Or we're getting rather close because we're expensive?
We're getting close. We haven't closed on all of these. This is parcel one. We still have parcel nine. So we're right at a little over 100,000.
May I speak? If at any point in time we believe that we might exceed the budget, we would have to go back to MoDOT and ask to amend the budget.
To get more money from them?
From the project.
All right.
So what we have left is construction next year. So if we believe that we're going to run over budget and we need additional funds, we would apply to MoDOT and ask them to allow us to reallocate from the balance for the construction to complete this section of the project. That doesn't mean that when we go out to bid, there will be insufficient money
funds
to do construction.
Yeah, that's you see where I'm going. Yes.
Exactly.
Okay.
So
thank you.
We're okay for now.
Thank you. That's where I wanted to get to.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you, Dan. Seeing none, Mr. City Attorney, second reading by title only, please.
Bill number 6103, second reading and consideration for an adoption. An ordinance authorizing the city administrator to enter into temporary construction easement, permanent wall and sidewalk easement agreement between the city of Brentwood and Envelope Manufacturing Company at 200 Hanley Industrial Court, Brentwood, Missouri 63144.
Thank you. The chair would entertain a motion.
Motion to perfect Bill 6103 into ordinance form.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the Board of Aldermen adopt Bill number 6103 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion? Okay, seeing none, roll call, please.
Plofka?
Here.
Wiggy?
Yes.
Lockmiller?
Yes.
Kramer?
Here. Yes.
O'Neill?
Yes.
Leahy?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Demmett?
Yes.
Motion passes after the signature by the mayor. Mayor's signature. Bill 6103 will become ordinance 4754.
Thank you. Item number 13 on tonight's agenda, resolutions. We have two resolutions this evening. The first one is resolution number 1061. Alderman Kramer, do you have a synopsis of that resolution?
I do, Your Honor. The resolution has to do with the general municipal election that's to be held here in our city on the fourth day of April, 2017, and supports the state of Missouri and in the ordinances of the city of Brentwood, Missouri, requiring a general municipal election to be held within the city on the first Tuesday after the first Monday in April of next year, April 4th, 2017. At the general municipal election, there shall be elected one mayor, one municipal judge, one alderman or alderwoman from each of wards 1, 2, 3, and 4, each of whom shall hold office for a term of 2 years and or until a successor is elected and qualifies. Resolution number 1061.
Thank you.
Motion to approve resolution 1061 by voice vote.
Second.
Or acclamation.
It's been moved and seconded that the board adopt resolution number 1061. Is there any discussion? Okay, all in favor of resolution 1061, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Are there any opposed? It's unanimous. 1061 is adopted. The second item is 13B, resolution number 1062. Alderman Kramer, synopsis, please.
Yes, Your Honor. There is an amended version, I believe, here this evening for resolution number 1062. The Parks and Recreation Department is recommending two fee changes for the year 2017. And as part of the budgeting process for the Parks and Recreation Department, staff required to complete an annual review of all the fees being charged by our city and the Parks and Recreation Department. Staff proposes to increase the rental fee for the use of park pavilions and is recommending changing the structure for field rentals. Our Public Works Committee members voted unanimously in recommending the language contained within resolution number 1062.
Thank you.
Your motion, Your Honor, to perfect resolution 1062 as amended prior to the meeting to be approved by acclamation.
Second. Okay, it's been moved and seconded that the board adopt resolution 1062 as amended. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor of resolution 1062, say aye.
Aye.
Are there any opposed? It's unanimous. Resolution 1062 is adopted by the board. Item number 14 on tonight's agenda, Accounts Against the City, Mr. Alderman Dimmitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have reviewed the warrant list with the city administrator and would recommend approval of the warrant list in the amount of $103,948.37.
Second. It's been moved and seconded that the Board of Aldermen approve the warrant list as submitted. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, we're going to have a roll call on this one because it's money. Roll call, please.
Plufka?
Yes.
Waggy?
Yes.
Lockmiller?
Yes.
Kramer?
Yes.
O'Neill?
Yes.
Leahy?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Dimmitt?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Great. Our bills will be paid for another month. Item number 15 on the agenda, 15A is my report. I actually have a topic that I'm going to discuss this evening, and I'm going to beg a few minutes of your time because I think it's important, and that is the topic of compensation of city employees. And many of you who were on the board last fall remember that we had a great deal of discussion in the summer and the fall last year about our compensation plan, and ultimately in November we adopted a compensation plan. And I think I wrote a couple of articles about it, actually, for the newspaper, because I thought it was a very, very important thing that the board did. And I'd like to remind everybody this evening why I think it's so important what the board did. The first and most important thing, the part of the compensation plan, is the market-based philosophy of compensation. Prior to the adoption of that plan, Brentwood's employee compensation philosophy, such as it was subjective. It was kind of all over the board, and the agreement of the Board of Aldermen on a market-based system for compensation is incredibly important to the city. The reason I say that is because we have a $7 million payroll on a budget, an operating budget of about $11 million, maybe $12 million. So, compensation of our employees is a enormous percent of where we spend the taxpayers' money. And if we do that in a way that makes sense, then we are, in my opinion, upholding our trust to the citizens. If we do that in a way that is less than rational, then I think we're letting our citizens down. And I would submit to the board that the adoption of the market-based system is by far the most rational system you can adopt for compensation. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, and I know most of the board is, but I want to explain it a little bit because I think there's been a lot of discussion, for example, about, well, this job is dangerous, so it should make more money than other jobs. Well, yes and no. Under a market-based compensation philosophy, the only question that you need to ask is what are similar people in similar jobs being paid, right? That is the only relevant question. Supply and demand works out all the rest of the stuff, okay? The board adopted a compensation plan whereby we adopted 14 comparator cities, 14 cities that are similar to Brentwood, similar to what Brentwood wants to be, and we look at those 14 comparator cities for how we measure our compensation. So we have defined those 14 cities as our market, And when we look at those 14 cities and we get an accurate bead on what a job that is similar to what is being done in Brentwood is paid, then we've answered the entire question of whether a job is dangerous or whether a job is, you know, whatever. you've answered the entire question. You simply look at what the market is compensating that skill set, and you offer the compensation accordingly. Now, when the board did that, I think the board did a very sensible thing. What they said was, we're going to set our target to be at the 75th percentile of that, right? So out of those 14 cities, right, we wanted to be in the upper upper quarter, right? The 75th percentile would be exactly 3/4 of the way. If you break that down into numbers for any given position, then what we're talking about is we would be the number 1, 2, 3, or 4 city, right, out of 14, right? If you listed all the 14 cities for each position and how much they paid, we would be in the top 4. Ideally, we would be at number 4 if we were on target for every single position. Of course, that's not possible. But, you know, there was a lot of talk about, well, you know, we're supposed to be at 75th and we're really at, you know, above market or whatever. You know, if the target is 75th, then what you do is you just hold that top position at what it is until the market comes up to the level that that position is at, right? So if we're currently number 1, right, then we just wait until eventually we'll be number 2 and eventually we'll be number 3 and we'll be at the target for that position, right? And you got to keep in mind, we're not doing this position by position every single year. So we're always going to have some positions where we're number 1. We're going to have some positions where we're maybe number even 4 or 5, right? But the idea is that on average, we would be at the 75th percentile for these positions, all right? And what that means is we're going to be in the top, you know, 1, 2, or 3 most of the time, right? And I think that's a very sensible way to approach your compensation, because it takes all of the discussion out of it that is much more subjective. And again, I have a great deal of respect. I mean, we just heard about, you know, what our firemen go through, putting on Kevlar and Kevlar helmets and Kevlar shields to go into a burning building. You know, our police officers are out there every day dealing with, you know, all sorts of potential danger, right? I don't in any way detract from what they do, and I have the utmost respect for what they do. But when it comes to setting the compensation for what they do, I can't let my emotional attachment to what they're doing and, you know, guide my decision on how to compensate them for those roles, right? I simply have to be a good steward of the taxpayers' money, and I have to say, hey, I need a rational way to justify my compensation of these people, right? And the other argument that comes up a lot is, well, you know, but our firefighters and our policemen are the best. And I think they are. I actually believe that, right? But if you go to Maplewood, I guarantee you that the mayor of Maplewood thinks that his firefighters and his police officers are the best. And if you go to Richmond Heights, you're going to hear the same thing. So, again, that gets to be a bit of a subjective measure, right? And what I'm trying to say is that I think we've gone from a system that was maybe a bit more subjective or didn't really have a guiding philosophy to one that has a guiding philosophy, and that's the market philosophy. And I think that's absolutely the right move for the city. I think if you look at the projections to what a market philosophy does for us over the next 10 years, you will see that it allows us to continue to grow as a city, to continue to offer services to the citizens, and do it in a way that is responsible and makes sense. And I just feel so strongly about this that I had to take this opportunity to remind the board and everybody here why we did that and why I think it's such a good thing. And like I said, I don't say that for or against any particular thing. I'm simply saying it because I truly believe it. In any type of employee compensation, the market philosophy is the right way to go. So that's my report. Alderman, I'm sorry, I've lost my agenda. 15B. Alderman Plufka.
No report.
No report. Alderman Leahy.
Public Works will meet on Wednesday, December the 14th at 4:30 here in the council room.
Thank you. Director Kirkemeyer, Director of Planning and Development.
No report.
Alderman Dimmitt, Ways and Means?
Ways and Means will meet December 8th.
Okay.
Is that not correct?
December 8th? Oh, that was a question.
That's
sorry.
The first Wednesday.
That's a Thursday, isn't it?
That's a Thursday.
Oh, is it?
I believe it is the first.
Yeah, are we meeting the first or the eighth?
December The first.
December the first.
Yes.
I stand corrected. We're meeting December the first at 6 o'clock.
And the 8th over at Dimmitt's house.
Oh no, we gotta have public meeting.
Let's see.
City Attorney.
Mr. City Attorney.
No report, sir.
Madam City Administrator.
No report.
Mr. Excise Commissioner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have, you have in front of you an application for a liquor license for Highway 61 Roadhouse and Kitchen. It's a one-day event at the Drury, and I would move for approval of same.
Second.
I'm sorry, go ahead. So you've been moved and seconded?
Yes.
It's been moved and seconded that the board adopt the request for the temporary liquor permit. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor of the temporary liquor permit, say aye.
Aye.
Are there any opposed? It's unanimous. The Highway 61 Roadhouse will have a temporary liquor permit. Madam Library Liaison.
No report.
Municipal League, I don't have anything to report on the Municipal League. And Historical Society, Chief, nothing? Very good. Are there any announcements? Alderman Lockmiller.
Ward 3 meeting right here next Tuesday at 7 o'clock on the 27th.
Any other announcements? Alderwoman O'Neill.
Thank you. Ward 4 will meet on Tuesday, December 13th at 6 o'clock in the Brentwood Forest Condo Association Clubhouse.
Okay. Alderman Leahy.
Thank you, Your Honor. The Boy Scouts of America just completed its two-weekend activity called Scouting for Food. It was our 32nd year. Started here in St. Louis, and Brentwood and the Boy Scouts, both the Cubs and the Boy Scouts Adventures, have participated all 32 years. We collected 245 boxes of canned goods. For the console area, we collected our third highest collection at 2.2 million canned goods, and those will be in the pantries. I think it's a total of, I want to say 514 pantries in the St. Louis area by Tuesday of this week. The Scouts are very grateful for the generosity of all of those here in Brentwood that did participate. It is not too late if you wish to contribute. The Mayor's Goodwill right here on Manchester here in Brentwood would be happy to accept any food donations up to the 26th of November. And again, I'd like to thank the City of Brentwood for making the old firehouse bays available, the Public Works Department for helping me get the equipment we needed to set up, and the residents for making a very generous donation to the program.
Thank you. Any further announcements? Yeah, along that same lines, the Brentwood firefighters are going to be doing their community outreach, the Toys for Tots. Their Fill Up the Ambulance with Unwrapped Presents is going to be on December 10th. And I just want to let the board know that technically that is using city property for the Toys for Tots promotion, but I assured our fire department that I didn't think our board would have any issue with that. So if anyone on the board has a problem with that, now would be the time to object. But we've been doing it for quite a while, so I think it's a good cause. Great. Let's see. Item number 18 on the agenda. Oh, sorry, 17 on the agenda. I've skipped right over Alderman Dimmitt.
That's okay.
New business. Alderman Dimmitt has a brief presentation or report on the Ways and Means Committee that's been working with the budget.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am happy to report that the Ways and Means Committee has completed its review of the proposed 2017 budget. We were able to accomplish this in two instead of the planned three or four meetings. But at the same time, we were able to extremely vet the proposed budget. And the first meeting, we looked at policy or philosophy questions on budgeting, how we want to spend money. The second meeting, we really kind of got down into the weeds, and all of the committee people had an opportunity to ask questions about specific line items, whether it's revenue or whether it's expenditures. And I think we've come out of this with a really good budget.
And I have to compliment the other committee members. I think they showed that they were very prepared for those meetings, and they asked very thoughtful questions and raised a lot of really good issues. And without those, I don't think we could come and present a budget to you like we have. The purpose of tonight is not, this is not pursuant to a public hearing. The schedule is that we're going to take that up the first meeting of December 5th with the Board of Aldermen. The purpose of tonight is simply just to kind of introduce those of you who aren't that familiar with the budget to just some general thoughts and some general ideas, in the hopes that between now and the next Board of Aldermen meeting, if you have any questions, if you have any concerns, if you see that there's some something in there in terms of an expenditure that's missing, that you'll bring it to our attention or to staff's attention. So we've got a chance to take that. We have time to take care of that. A quick summary is, when we looked at the proposed budget, and I apologize, there's some of you, this is going to be the fourth time that you've heard this, but there are a few things that jumped out to the committee. Number one was the proposed general fund surplus. In years past, we have budgeted rather significant surpluses. In 2015, I believe it was approximately $960,000 surplus. This year, it was projected to be around $180,000 to $200,000. In the upcoming budget, it was proposed to be $25,000. And that begged the question, why do we have such a small projected surplus? Is it because our revenue is not where we thought it would be? Is there a decrease in that, or is there an increase in the expenditures? And it's kind of a little bit of the latter. We did notice that our revenue is not growing like we hoped that it would. You know, we have the four funds, but I'm focusing in on the general fund, because the general fund is the big one. It's more than the other three combined, and it's the fund out of which most of our expenses are paid. And in so two things that I noticed when going over that budget was, number one, we haven't met our projected general fund revenue for 2 years in a row. And worse than that, if it's worse, our actual revenue has been decreasing. In 2014, our revenue was, in the general fund again, was $12,521,000. In 2015, it was down 4.9% to $11,900,000. And this year, it is expected, we had to readjust it, and it's expected that it will be down just under 0.5% to $11.8 million. Because of that, in the budget that we had, there was a projected growth of 3% of sales tax revenue. The committee didn't think that there was any evidence to support that 3% growth, so we requested that staff rerun the numbers and recalculate the projected revenue so that it would show a flat, no growth at all in sales tax revenue. But because we had a $25,000 budget surplus, when they did that, that obviously put us into the red. So then we asked staff to go ahead and do its magic and reduce the expenditures accordingly so that it would get us back. And they did a great job. I forgot to compliment them as well, because they have been terrific in this whole process. And what they came back is with, now in front of you, is the budget with a surplus of $35,000. And the philosophy behind that is there are a lot of items in there, a number of items in there that we think, and staff thinks, we need to address. They've been neglected over the years. And we have the revenue to go ahead and do it. Even with our revenue dropping, we have the stream there to handle that. And so some of the big ticket items, if you will, one is originally was to finish up all the streets in the city, in the residential area. And that was going to require a transfer of $400,000 from general fund to capital improvements. We scaled back on that. Now we're only going to do 25 of the 30 streets. And so instead of transferring 400, we're only transferring $150,000. And the reason for that is one of the streets that was going to be done is Pine, which was a rather large expenditure, and that's off for 2017. Those streets will still be completed in 2018, but instead of doing them all in 2017, we're going to spread it out over 2 years. We also are funding a new program that was requested by Parks and Recreation, and that is finally a program to address the trees that the city owns. We have over 300 in the right-of-ways in the residential areas. And we didn't have funding for that, and so the director asked for $320,000. And that's going to fund primarily our independent contractor that we talked about at the last meeting. So we got, and that's not a recurring expense. You know, that is something to kind of get us to where we hopefully we should have been. And once we do that, then we can scale it back. Also modeled in are the cost of two police officers of $140,000. Now that hasn't been approved, but we still needed to model that in there, and the cost of a new position at staff. So those are some of the main or the new expenditures that weren't there in 2016. So that's where we are, and I will make this offer to you. If any of you want to meet, if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to sit down with you and hopefully answer any of your questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I had suggested to Alderman Dimmitt that it might be a good time. We've been at it a while tonight, but if the board has an interest, you know, a motion to go into a quasi-committee of the whole and just have a general discussion of budget issues might be a helpful thing this evening. I don't know if any of you have any burning desire to talk about any of the budget issues, but I would much prefer that the board have this discussion today rather than, say, 2 or even 4 weeks hence, when the budget either has to be approved or we enter a year with no budget. So having done that once, I have no desire to repeat the experience, and would make that suggestion if anybody on the board feels like that would be useful. Alderman Dimmitt. Sorry, Plufka.
It's okay. I'm going to say here next time we call for a vote.
Yeah, there you go.
So we have to make a motion to go into some sort
of... Yeah, it's as simple as making a motion to go to quasi-committee as the whole, and that way you can just talk freely about it. You're not proposing the board take any action. You could just have it kind of like what we do at workshops, right?
All right.
I mean, you could just talk about, hey, you know, I'm thinking about this. I want to talk about that.
Well, I'm interested in having a conversation about that, so I would make that motion to go into a quasi-committee of the whole.
All right.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board go into a quasi-committee of the whole. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Are there any opposed? Great. Like I said, just like a workshop, raise your hand, talk away.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I thought you spoke eloquently with regard to the compensation plan, and I'm going to take a little bit of a different tack with all respect. I was in favor of the compensation plan. I am still in favor of the compensation plan. I voted for it. I still believe in it. I do not believe that it's an either-or proposition, that we either adhere to it without any deviation whatsoever, or we abandon it completely. I believe that there is a way for us to navigate through and remain true to that plan, but still recognize the fact that we did not apply this plan into a vacuum. We applied this plan into a situation where we had internal inconsistencies with how we paid our employees, as well as external inconsistencies with our competing communities. And there was a lot of adjustment that had to be done to plug people into this plan in the first place, and we can't forget that that's people we're talking about. And the compensation plan itself contemplated non-base building bonuses and cost of living adjustments during the time frame when you're dealing with this adjustment into the reality of adhering to this market-based plan, which I fully support. As I understand it from looking at the budget, we have 60 employees or better who are, as a byproduct of the compensation plan, are not eligible for any kind of a base salary increase in the coming year. If our payroll is $7 million, I believe that's an accurate number, then each 1% increase for them would likely amount to about $70,000, I would imagine. I'm not a math whiz, but that's... And so what I would like us to do as we see this budget for the first time and start asking questions and having the conversation, to just keep in mind the idea that we try to carve out some amount of money, and it wouldn't even take $70,000, because what I'm talking about is trying to help the half of the employees or so that are not eligible for increases under the STEP plans that we've adopted, to allow for the providing of some amount of money to our city administrator and to our executive staff to be able to identify folks within those 60 employees who are doing an exceptional job and continue to do an exceptional job for the city, that they be given some form of financial reward that doesn't do violence to the compensation plan, but also still acknowledges the fact that we are a city of people, and that in some cases we have people who have devoted decades of their life to this city. And I want to recognize that, or at least I want to try to recognize it within the context of the budget. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Alderman Plufka, a.k.a. Dimmitt. Is it your suggestion that that be whatever the cost of labor, however you want to call it, would be merit-based, or would it apply to all of them that are topped out?
It would be, in my vision of it, it would be merit-based, it would be non-base building, and it would be an option for a city administrator who was doing a year-end interview with somebody who has done an exceptional job, and under any other circumstance, other than the fact that their salary is already capped by virtue of the compensation plan, they would be eligible, and in fact would be enthusiastically giving them a step increase.
Okay. Well, I'd like to second that, I guess, if you need to do that. I appreciate the fact that we have whatever number of employees who are at the top. I get that, believe me, I do. But I also appreciate the fact that in this day and age, people looking at their household budgets, you know, they look at what their revenue is and they look at their expenses, and they have no control over the revenue or over the expenditures. And their expenses continue to climb. And so each year, when we don't provide any type of an increase, whether it's a cost of living adjustment or whatever, those folks are stuck there. And less of their money is going to be available at the end of the year for them. And I'm not suggesting something we do long term, but maybe to transition from going from this position where it was a 3% every year to now this idea that you're capped, you're not going to get anything, you can't get anything, but we're going to pay you something if it's warranted to try and help you, to ease you into this, to this system.
Mr. Chairman, okay.
We're in the committee as a whole. So.
It's hard to undo the Roberts formality.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's a good thing. I just want to extend my kudos to the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee. The presentation that I just heard was not only excellent in many ways, but it was probably the more easiest. For the layperson or the resident to be able to understand and take in kind of what we're talking about. There are some items within the budget that I think probably warrant some more discussion. I look forward to the potential of spending time with the chairman on some of those topics. And even the one that was just raised here a moment ago, that potentially is polarizing depending on what your viewpoints are. But I also wanted to add some illustration for the residents and remind all of us that even in the best years where we really felt that we had a budget where the expenditures and the revenues coming in were locked up and very confident, we still had budget amendments and we still had unforeseen things that happen. We will continue to have those. We're in an excellent position to be able to have the planning that our forefathers put in place, the stores and the layout of our city that currently is. I'm excited once again for 2017, and thanks to the committee for their work again. Thank you.
Could I bring up another topic?
Sure.
The master plan for the parks is the most detailed I've seen since I've been an alderwoman, and I think there are items in it that are to be commended, but the one that I would like to have further discussion of is the dog park. that putting it at Norm West is not high priority as far as residents of Ward 4 and maybe some other wards go. I'd love to have some other options to move it to Hanley Industrial as a substitute for the skateboard park. The location of that skateboard park would be an excellent large and small dog park. And perhaps the users of a skateboard park would be happy to go to the Norm West area because there wouldn't be as many of them. So I don't have an exact proposal, but I would really like to sit down and revisit that at some point if we can.
I think in discussing something of that nature, a new facility in our parks, I think we really need as part of the budget a five-year capital improvement plan so that I could see, you know, if all of a sudden we're picking up a new facility and the cost of running that facility, what are the state and conditions of their existing facilities? Do we need to bring those up to snuff before we start looking at another facility? In this, all I have as far as the capital improvement plan is what all the departments are proposing next year. I really need something 5 years down the road to be able to look at before I can tell, you know, say that that's a good idea or not. You know, if we've got down at Memorial, we've got a ceiling falling in on that little center down there, and that's in the budget for this year, 18. I don't know whether we need to address that first before we even think about a dog park, but I would like to see that as part of the budget going forward as a five-year capital improvement plan for each department.
Have you seen the parks master plan? Because I think that actually is exactly what you're asking for.
And it does it per year?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I haven't.
Yeah. Well,
that's a good idea,
I'm sure Bola will be happy to get you a copy, or Eric will get you a copy of the Parks Master.
Well, and I think that would be useful for every department. I mean, if the police are looking to replace new cars 2 or 3, 4 years down the road, and something else comes up and we have to shift that to the next year, I think it's just hard to do it with only 1 year in front of us. And I think it would be useful across the whole board.
So, you know, with regards to the dog park, in the budget there is, I believe, $216,000 in Parks and Rec for replacing the tennis courts and replacing the sand volleyball court. So out of Ways and Means, we did decide to carry that forward, but we wanted to have in parallel a dog park conversation. So I think that's why we got some correspondence about potential costs, potential locations. For my thought process, at least, the idea was let's go ahead and budget that money and then continue to have the conversation about possibly a dog park. And if that means that we have to wait a year to replace the tennis courts because we find a better path on the dog park, then we budget money for it, and then we can make a decision.
I'll stay with the dog park to start with, but I have two issues I'd like to do. The dog park, I think, is a nice idea, and we did try it earlier. Unfortunately, weren't successful. But your parks program is in a three-community park consortium, and there is a dog park that is available. If we're running tight with how we want to spend money and stuff, I think the Parks Department should really push using the dog park that is currently available to us instead of reinventing the wheel. We spent 9 years fighting over what to do with the rec center and whether or not we were going to duplicate with physical fitness equipment and stuff and duplicate the heights because it was a block and a half closer than going over to Dale Avenue. I think the dog park is headed in the same arrangement, that if you're going to start duplicating facilities that may not be fiscally responsible. The first comment that came out was on the compensation and whether or not we stay with the market-based plan or look for a way to at least keep increasing the employees' compensation so because they are doing a good job. And this is part of the fight that we had, or heavy discussion we had, over whether or not to go to the market-based plan. It is my perception that if Brentwood is running the top line on almost all the positions and you're trying to get to a market-based arrangement, you need to unfortunately bite the bullet and hold the line on your cost and allow all your other 14 communities to quickly catch up to where we are. And the more that we keep supplementing it with funding only makes that time go out further and further until we get into the market base. We agreed in the discussions that we were not going to cut anybody's pay to work with, and that we would go through this hard term, allowing everybody to balance out and get on the market scale so that we could correct years of, unfortunately, short-sightedness. I understand not having raises in all of this if you're frozen. I work in the public, in the private sector, and we went 6 years without having a raise. Now, we did get profit sharing because the company was profitable and the owners of the family business were kind enough to share the profits with the employees. But it does happen, and I think we have to look at that we're paying top market, and at some point you have to allow the system to get back into sync with the other 14 to work with. I understand we will have other discussions later this evening on other topics that are in the budget.
I don't think so.
I believe you have an executive session scheduled.
Yeah, but I don't think there's anything from the budget in there.
Okay, thank you. That's all I have at this time, Your Honor.
Bola, do we know from Higbee where we stand on that evaluation?
We just haven't had time trying to get this budget out on time to meet and review that and model it into the budget. I think we mentioned at the last Ways and Means Committee that once we adopt the budget, we'll have an opportunity to revisit that, present that at Ways and Means, and then present a budget amendment if one is required, or to even amend the compensation plan. So I think at the last meeting, I had suggested that the board needed to adopt an ordinance as part of this budget process with the compensation plan. I would like to now recommend that we hold off until we've had a chance to present that to you and then bring that back with a new compensation schedule if there is one.
Thank you.
Is that the decision where we make the yearly decision as to whether this is a step plan or not?
Yeah, so the way that works under the ordinance that we passed is every 2 years we have a review, and since the original plan was done in 2014, even though it wasn't adopted until 2015, that data is 2014 data. So here being 2016, we've contracted with Linda to go out and do a review. And she's gathered that data, and I think we've even gotten a preliminary of it, but we're not in a position to incorporate it into the budget at this late date. So the plan is, if there's any recommended adjustments to the grids, that it would come, you know, kind of after the fact. For the budget purpose, what we did was we did model in that every single person who was eligible for a step would get a step if the board approved the budget. So that's been modeled into the budget.
So the board has not actually voted whether or not this is or is not a step plan. It's just, if you pass the budget, you just made that decision.
No.
Okay, we are going to have a board vote as to whether or not this board agrees to make this 2017 a step year or a non-step year. We are going to do that vote.
We can have it as it, well, the ordinance says the board has to vote on it. If the budget contains it and the board approves the budget, then, but if you want to divide the question, we can certainly divide the question and have a separate vote. That's not a problem. And I'm happy to divide the question if you want.
I would love to make that motion that we divide. Meeting of the committee of the whole. There is no motions
I can certainly, we can take it up as a divided question. Okay. That's fine.
So, can I ask a question?
And just while we're on that topic, let me say one other thing. I have actually asked Dusty to schedule meetings with all of you in small groups to talk a little bit about the compensation plan. There was a lot going on when we passed it, and I think a refresher for everyone on how the ordinance operates is, regardless of how you feel about it and what what I want to do is make sure we sit down and we all go through it so that we all have the same idea of how the ordinance operates, because there was a lot of confusion at the time, and I think there's some confusion about it. We need to know the ordinance, so I'm asking for 20 minutes with each of you to kind of go through that. But again, that's not to go any particular direction. It's simply on the mechanics of, yeah, every 2 years we do this, and here's how we would do it, and so forth, just on the operation of the ordinance. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to ask a question on a specific page. I didn't know if we wanted to get that deep.
It's your meeting.
Well, could I ask you a question on page 16?
Which page?
Page 16. And I'm looking under my favorite category, stormwater. And
your new name is going to be Stormwater Steve.
If we look over there where we've got all the assigned fund balances, even for equipment replacement, capital reserves, how are those allocated as and divided up as when we have the reserve, the total reserve? I mean, I know how we got the stormwater this year.
Right.
The other ones for like capital and equipment.
So we really do have a capital improvement budget. And the capital improvement budget, the detail, is updated every year by each department. And that is provided to the finance director. And it's the budget or the expense for each item each year that you all see in that tab titled capital improvement budget. So we do have a detailed budget. And it's the departments that determine based on the useful life of each of the equipment when it is replaced. If the board would like to see that detail, we can share it. But I rely primarily on the departments to tell us when the useful life of that equipment has been met and it's eligible to be replaced. And if you look at the policy, the comprehensive fund balance policy, it doesn't have a specific goal for equipment replacement or capital reserve. It just says that there should be sufficient funds. I'm not quoting that exactly, to fund the replacement of all those items. So that is how we get to those dollar amounts.
Okay, so those are pretty well set in stone. They're not able to be tweaked. For instance, if I wanted to move a little down the stormwater.
From one of those items?
Yeah.
Then that means equipment does not get replaced.
Okay. That answers my question. Thank you.
Well, can I follow up with you with that question? It is my understanding that last year's amended to the budget was to move the $400,000 into stormwater as an annual appropriation, and that this board voted in affirmative to that. Am I misunderstanding or miscalling what we did last year?
No.
No, you're correct.
But this year, we did not put $400,000 into stormwater. We have budgeted only $150,000 going into stormwater. So am I not mistaken that if we want to change that, we have to change the bill and ordinance that we did last year?
He's saying that he thinks it was an underwriting.
What we are doing this year is we are adding an additional $150,000 to the $400,000 that was appropriated last year. The reason why we have to appropriate that every year is because it is an assigned fund balance. It is not a committed fund balance. A committed fund balance keeps it there indefinitely. We cannot touch it. But assigned, we have to reappropriate it every year. That's the difference.
But wasn't the motion last year to make a $400,000 commitment to the stormwater fund each year to build that fund?
No. No, it was just a one time for fiscal year 16.
Thank you.
One of the nice things about committee as a whole is the mayor gets to talk. Well, at least nice things for me. And I guess I would, I would offer you one thought on, and Alderman Plufka, I appreciate your remarks, and Alderman Dimmitt, and you guys, I fully appreciate what you're saying, but I would offer this as a counter to that, and ask you to think about it. The number one recommendation that came back from Higbee was that we needed a philosophy, right? It wasn't that we do any particular thing; it was that we need a philosophy, and the philosophy that we adopted was a market philosophy. And I submit to you that if you allocate any compensation to any person in the city for any reason that is not supported by the market, right, then you have abandoned that market philosophy. Now, I'm not saying that that's the end of the market philosophy per se, but you certainly can't go to the market and justify something on the basis of, you simply can't. You can't be consistent with the market philosophy if the market doesn't support what you're doing. And so You know, in a number of cases, I'm going to tell you, I know for a fact that we are sitting at the number one spot. And if you increase that number one person's compensation under any rationale, you are, in fact, departing from the market philosophy. And I don't think there's any two ways around that. And I'm not saying that the board can't do that. The board certainly can. I don't think I would be in favor of it. And like I said, I fully appreciate what you're saying. But the other thing that I would point out is that our ordinance specifically did not include anything like a cost of living. There is nothing in our ordinance that says cost of living. And that was by design. There is nothing in that ordinance that says cost of living because cost of living is inconsistent with the market approach that we've adopted. Any other questions, comments? Should we go out of the committee as a whole?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we go back into regular board meeting format. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Are there any opposed? Great. Item number 18 on tonight's agenda, the hearing of any matter of public interest upon the request of any person present. If anyone would care to come forward and address the board, you will have 3 minutes to do so. And I see perennial favorite Louise Charbonneau approaching the bench.
Well, because I have a fiduciary responsibility to my own self, perennials are a better buy. Mayor Thornton, Christopher, I have to thank you for probably the clearest explanation that I've heard in all the discussion of the last 2 years of the compensation plan. So thank you very much for that. But all of this talk, I don't know where to start because I have so many things to say. Let me do the one that I planned and then we'll segue into the others. Again, since I meandered through the comprehensive plan, which is dated October 6, 10 years ago, and it's page 18, infrastructure and community facilities goals, ranked in order of community priority, improve the stormwater management system, goes on about Deer Creek and Black Creek are the primary waterways, significant rainfall events, overflow caused damage to adjacent commercial, light manufacturing properties. Must continue to work with MSD. Last year, this board was totally committed to understanding that that's one of our biggest problems. It's 10 years later, ladies and gentlemen, and nothing's been done. If we continue to dole out raises and we continue to fund dog parks, and it'll never be done. It's 10 years later. When do the residents of South Brentwood, do we have to secede and to get things done? Steve did an admirable job. When we talked about going back from 4-year terms to 2-year terms, Alderman Saunders suggested 3 years, and that sounded anathema. I never heard of a 3-year term anywhere. Later found out that Maplewood does. So we wouldn't maybe have to re-educate every year what the thinking was when something came about. But this full board of aldermen, not you same members, was committed to stormwater control. We can't just throw $150,000 in the pot if we're going to have a pot. And I've heard Administrator Akande say $1 million in the pot. Maybe we need $3 million in that pot, and it does need to be a committed fund. 10 years ago, the number one priority, and we're still blasé, blasé. Now, with regard to the works of the Ways and Means Committee, thank you, thank you, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for getting the administrator to back off on our revenue prognostications because they may more closely reflect what is the trend. 9% of retail in the United States right now is already on the internet. So unless you get people to say, okay, I'll pay sales tax on internet sales, that's going to just continue to go that way. I want to thank Alderman Weggie for proposing the 50% goal for the reserves. But if we've got projections of revenue down, we've got more money that we want to try to hold in reserve, that signals to me that maybe we need to be more judicious in our spending. We're going to have to do a little belt tightening. So I don't understand talk of raises. That's why we paid Ms. Higby, and that's what we voted to do last year. And I don't know, Mr. Dimon, if you misspoke, but you said that the long-term employees, well, we got away with, we're done with longevity pay. So if you think you can do better, and this is no disrespect to any employee of the city of Brentwood, if you can find somebody who is paying more than us in a given position, or the working conditions are better. All we're required is to provide a clean, safe workplace and a reasonable wage and instructions on what your duties are. That's the employer bond. Then it's up to the employee to meet the expectations and to be, and for a lot of jobs, be self-motivated. But I don't know if you misspoke when you said that they see their revenues, that families can't increase their revenues, they don't have control over expenditures. They do have control over expenditures. So I don't know, Mr. Dimon, if you misspoke or what expenditures you were thinking with regard to light and gas, but you can certainly not have an iPhone. You can have a consumer cellular phone like I have. You can certainly drive a car that's 3, 4, and 5 years old. You do have control, and that's the only place you have control over expenditures. So we've already got a wind it up. I am.
I can tell you're wound up.
I'm trying to wind down, sir, because by this time of the night, I'm usually dozing, and I'm not tonight.
Yes, ma'am.
Payroll is virtually 75% of the general fund expense, and I want that piece of the pie shrunk, not expanded. I really believe you have to reject all of these side issues, concentrate, remember your fiduciary responsibility. Oh, and one more thing with regard to raises. My Social Security is not going up.
Yes, it is.
My private pension from the retail clerks is not going up. And most private pensions in this country after 2008 fell into the red zone. They invented red, green, and yellow zones. So they're still recovering. So any talk of pension increase, where back in the good old days, my father-in-law was a Teamster, and they got increases every year, and a $400 bonus at the end of the year, which Grandpa handed everybody a $50 bill. Well, I would love to be able to hand everybody in Brentwood a $50 bill, but times have changed. As always, thank you for your service. Thank you for remembering that Demos means people, and we're in a democracy.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lori Coulter. I'm chairman of Brentwood's Communication Committee, and I've met most of you, but to those I haven't, hello. And I want to first start off by saying, Mr. Dimon, that I really did appreciate your presentation, and I do not envy the work that goes into what you all are doing, and both on the budget as well as what you do day in and day out. So thank you all. I'm here because I'm particularly interested in Brentwood's communication policy strategy, as well as just the output that we have on an ongoing basis, obviously. And in your presentation, I had only one concern, and what I heard, and I think we all should have had the same concern. You said you're projecting revenue to be down this year. And I don't disagree with Louise that online sales are definitely impacting retail sales across the board. And in what I do, I look at these numbers all the time. But what that tells me is that this is not a time to back off of investment in the future of our city's revenue. Instead, we need to be focused on what can we do to take Brentwood to the next level so that we secure our long-term potential and that we get ahead of the surrounding communities in regards to what's going on those trends, because that, you know, I work in retail. I sell to retailers, and I'm working in e-commerce, and I know the numbers, and they're not pretty. So what we need to do is not step away and say that budgets are down, but let's focus on moving the needle forward. So how do we do that? Well, I think number one, economic development is always a number one priority, but there's a lot that goes into economic development from the behind-the-scenes perspective. Brentwood is a great, great place to live. And you all are doing great things as a board that none of our residents know. So let me ask you this. Who's going to tell the residents about the new dog park? Or alternatively, who's going to tell residents that there's an alternative? We don't have to even build a new dog park, right? I don't think people are hearing these messages. And so my request to you is let's tell people, both our current residents, as well as the St. Louis region, the state in general, the greater Midwest, what a great place we have here. So not only are we one of the most probably solvent communities in the entire St. Louis County, I'm sure we could cite fact after fact there, but we have a very educated workforce, a very diverse community that you don't find in some of our neighboring cities. So let's tell people, let's tell businesses why it's so much easier to run a business in Brentwood. I have a business in downtown St. Louis. Tell me why I should be here.
No earning tax.
Other than that, tell me, you know what? Tell me how easy it is.
126,000 people transfer through Brentwood on a daily basis.
There you go. Let's tell the world. And then in addition to the economic benefits, I think there are a lot of things we can do to upgrade our just general marketing from a branding perspective. Let's have consistency, not just for the city, but all the individual departments need to be following Brentwood's branding guidelines. So that means when Parks and Rec, we shouldn't be saying Parks and Rec, we should be saying Brentwood's Parks and Rec, right? I want all of you to say Brentwood in front of our police department every single time. And if I ever see it in writing without Brentwood in front of it on Facebook or social media, maybe I'll give you a ticket. I don't know what I'll do. But I mean, I want to see policies so that we are better than every other community. This is not hard. Now, it does take work. And this is not a job BOLA should ever have to do. This is not a senior executive level position. This is a person that is really good at marketing, really good at writing copy. Now, the way cities communicate has changed in the last 5 years, right? The predominant way people are learning our messages, what is it?
Social media.
It's social media, right? That's a different type of communication style that's ongoing, and that means getting our messages out before the social media is bubbling up. So this is a different person than it probably used to be. So we want to make our current employees more productive. We want to invest in the future of the city. And we want to have consistent branding so that we're getting the best potential out of everything. Now, do I understand that we only have limited resources? Yes, but I have heard you talk nothing tonight about what the plans are for the future. And I hope you'll keep that in mind. So thank you. Obviously, I'm passionate. I'm happy to talk to anyone and everyone. Residents as well as the board as needed. So thank you.
Thank you. I also want to thank Lori for she's the first, I guess, citizen chairman of a committee we've had, and I appointed Lori for exactly that reason. She cares deeply about the subject and she knows a lot about it. So thank you, Lori, for taking that. Anyone else care to address the board this evening?
Thank you, Mayor Thornton. I thought that your, I'm sorry, I'm Catherine Danielle again, but I thought that your explanation of the compensation plan was excellent. It was clear, it was understandable, and, you know, I was reading over the bill that was passed by the board, and they do adopt a 75% market-based philosophy. You know, this bill also says that step increases are not guaranteed, are contingent upon the annual appropriation, and may be frozen at any time for the position or for the entire class as determined by the Board of Aldermen. So, you know, I think again, if you adopt the 75%, and I thought it was very clear in explaining it, by, you know, consistently every year determining that, oh, you know, the employees had a good performance evaluation, they'll go up the next step. What you're doing is just raising the whole floor. And you know, I think that you get further away from having these other communities come up to, you know, the Brentwood's, salary levels for each position when you're looking at a comparable position within those 14 communities. So I would just say that, you know, I know the employees of Brentwood work very hard and are very deserving, but there are many industries, there are many, many, businesses that in the past couple of years have not given cost of living increases or given salary increases. And I'm example of one. I'm a federal government employee, and my salary has been frozen for the past 5 years.
You know, for four of those years, we didn't even get a cost of living. So, you know, I think Louise is correct that, you know, you have to adjust your budget accordingly and your expenditures. But I also think that it's very easy to say that every single year employees should get another step increase. But, you know, you move further away from this market-based philosophy. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else care to address the board this evening? Okay, seeing none. Any aldermanic response? Seeing none. We have a closed meeting on the agenda this evening. If I could get a motion to go into closed session pursuant to RSMO 610-21-1, 2, and 3.
So moved.
Second, Your Honor.
It's been moved and seconded that the board enter into closed session pursuant to 610-21-1, 2, and 3. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please. Oh, Alderman Plofka.
Can we inform the audience that we'll adjourn?
Oh, yes. My fault. Closed session is closed pursuant to the Missouri Sunshine Law. We will be reconvening the meeting in about 5 minutes' time. It'll be closed, and we will adjourn from the closed meeting. So, yeah, you don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. So. roll call, please, on the motion.
Alderman Plofka?
Yes.
Alderman Weggie?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Motion passes.
All right, very good. We'll reconvene in 5 minutes' time in the conference room across the hall.